gives you political power. It is used by politicians as a grift. The race grift and black victimhood, okay, so it's really the industry of our day.
Yeah, permission to unload, since I'm a guest here.
Go ahead, dog.
Okay, let me set up for this even. Look, so I think, yeah, what you call the race grift, Sowell calls, I think, the race industry.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but it's actually gone beyond race. It's now well into the realm of even, you know, the gender identity politics. So, I mean, firstly, people have been, you know, you've got people, you've got all the wokers, all the people on the left, etc., looking forward to the grand cancellation of Gareth Cliff. You know, it's like they're waiting for it and they smell blood, and it's not going to happen because people have been trying to cancel Gareth Cliff since before I had a beard. I've had a beard for a long time, by the way. So it's not going to work. Firstly, Gareth has actually withstood quite a bit of this in his career, even in the media. It just won't work. And this is probably part of the reason why he created, you know, his platform to begin with, you know, so that he can actually not be accountable to someone who is willing to pander to whatever popular ideology is of the day. So it won't work. To maybe even contextualize this even further, who remembers, you know, just over a year ago when McGee, who I believe has the biggest podcast in the country right now, the Rainbow community tried to cancel McGee and his guests. You know, they had Old Mutual as a sponsor. Old Mutual immediately, you know, pulled their sponsorship of the show. And I think, I believe they were sitting maybe at about 100,000 YouTube subscribers at the time. They're on 500,000 right now. You know, so again, it's not going to work. And the wokists who are smelling blood here, sorry to disappoint you, but all of this might have actually, you know, gone into exponentially increasing Gareth Cliff's following online at the very least.
Mm.
And then on top of this, right, I've seen comments from people, you know, saying they try to really belittle not just Gareth Cliff, but they do this with me, they do this with other people, where they go ahead and say things like, you know, what does a DJ know about you know, the lived experience, or what does a DJ know about racism, or, you know, on the ground issues, etc., etc. Well, and I said this yesterday, that since they value degrees and all of that so much, we've seen this by how they really sucking up to Dr. Sizwe Mpofu-Walsh, of course, since mm-hmm. they value education so much in certain aspects, in certain fields, do they know that Gareth Cliff actually has a degree in politics? You know, I don't believe they know that. So again, that actually qualifies him to speak more on politics, probably philosophy and other things that a lot of these people on the left do. So, but again, you won't find Gareth coming out and saying that according to my learned opinion, etc. You know, because yeah, he's a principled person, of course. But maybe this is again maybe further evidence that the left doesn't have a lot of party tricks. They always bring up racism at every opportunity. My favorite morons, Eusebius Mukhaiza and Dr. Ibrahim Kendi, are quite good at this, actually.
We're naming them today.
I know, I'll name them. Hey, and
do
like
it,
I say,
man.
I'll say it to their face even, you know, like exactly. They're my favorite morons. They have no party tricks. At every opportunity, they have to bring it up. They have to write a book about this. And then, of mm-hmm. course, those on the opposite side of the spectrum, they then wait for them to write nonsense or speak on nonsense before they come out with their own books and actually profit off the left's idiocy, of course. But mm-hmm. they don't have any party tricks. They bring nothing to the table. They don't bring anything substantial to argue. You and we had Germinal G. Van on Man Patriot the one time, who was basically saying that, you know, it's funny how you don't even find these people in something like a STEM field where no one cares about your political ideology. You know, you're in an industry where people are trying to invent something, and it's a lot harder to invent something tangible than coming out and capitalizing or profiteering off your perceived oppression or invented atrocities, of course. Now, on Muzuli's lived experience comment, you know, so I'm a middle child. I've got two sisters, you know, obviously, since I'm a middle child, I've got an older sister, I've got a younger sister. And, you know, me and my sisters, we're pretty close, right? And I'm pretty sure if I go and ask them right now, if they have a lived experience of racism every day, these aren't people who are stuck behind a wall somewhere. You know, if I go and ask them about their lived experience of racism, I'm pretty sure they're probably going to cite little to none, if there's any. You know, so again, to build a narrative that as a black woman, the moment you leave your front door, you're confronted with patriarchy and racism and all of this, is actually not true. It is quite belittling to Black women out there who are actually doing a lot, not just for them, for their communities, but also for themselves in the career field, et cetera, et cetera. You know, I don't like reducing Black women to, oh no, you're just a Black woman. You know, that's really not the, that's not the way you approach anyone when you meet them. And certainly, even if, you know, you want to make a friend, you know, I don't look at Joe and say, oh, okay, cool, Joe, I like your skin tone, let's actually have a conversation and be friends here. That's not how people treat each other, and it's not how they haven't, it's not how they've treated each other since the time when, you know, race was actually used as a qualifier to determine things like genetic superiority under the ban of eugenics and Hitler's philosophies as well. So there's also that. I don't like that term of my lived experience as a Black woman. It's very belittling to the other Black woman and makes an assumption into other people's lives who you've never met. And then on top of this, right, the whole racism thing as well, I think it's also kind of put offside because, and it's funny that, you know, when you read books, particularly those written in the 80s and onwards, if racism is so bad in South Africa and is really at the top of the list of people's problems, why is it that we have a border issue where we've got an influx of illegal immigrants coming into the country who are predominantly Black, you know, or predominantly of Asian descent? Why, if racism is so bad here, why would people risk it all to actually come to this country? You know, if it's so bad, I mean, let's be honest here. They come here because they want to, they're typically enterprising and want to make or eke out a better life for themselves and potentially increase their standard of living, of course. But if racism is so bad, why would they do this? You know, they do this because racism is not as bad as people on the left come out, make it out to be. And the people who do make racism such a key issue are typically people who live a life of comfort. You know, in their comfort, sitting, you know, comfortably at home with a job, with a stable income, you know, with a plan B if the if Eskom's load shedding goes out, with Wi-Fi, fiber, uncapped internet, you know, those who can afford a Netflix subscription, a DSTV subscription. Only those people actually come out and then decide that, oh, no, we need to, you know, we need to build a movement around combating racism and the like. They don't represent the poor like they say, like they think they represent them. They really don't represent the victims like they say they represent them either, because they live, you know, they almost have delusions of grandeur where they want to decide for other people what their biggest issues are, which I find that quite arrogant. And yeah, it's textbook bigotry as well. But on top of this, maybe to wrap it up, Muzulu had an excellent opportunity to actually come out and educate people like me about One SA. And I've said this before, that I like what they're doing. I like the idea of saying, look, let's have some independent candidates, but let's maybe put them under one umbrella so that it's easier to actually spread our message, not just, you know, in a local context, but even nationally. I like the idea. And I really was looking forward to hearing more about One SA and what they plan to achieve specifically, even beyond the local government election. I didn't get a lot of that, or definitely most people didn't, because all of this is now overshadowed by deciding to be woke instead of now focusing on the idea at hand, which was supposed to be a discussion about the local government election and potentially even introducing us to One SA. I mean, let's be honest, a lot of people hadn't heard about One SA. Suddenly this clip comes out, this very curated segment of this clip comes out, and all of a sudden, instead of now focusing on One SA, we are now focusing on, you know, identity politics. So it's a lost opportunity for One SA. I was really expecting better. I really thought that One SA at the very least would be, would have people of higher caliber who are actually able to, you know, separate their own lived experience, if I can put it like that, and actually seek address issues directly. But that didn't happen in largest on the burning platform. It's sad to see. It's a wasted opportunity. But yeah, I really do expect more. And let's see where this actually takes us. Potentially, I might have even voted for them or whoever their candidate is where I live. That's no longer happening anymore because, you know, I haven't heard the messaging I might resonate with. Instead, I was served a plate of identity politics and I'm sending this order back. I don't even want my money back. Keep the change.
Yeah. Keep the change.